Okay, we are ready to begin. Woo, it's happening. Okay, so thank you all so much for coming to my lecture recital. Before we begin, I would like to recognize everybody who's helped me get so close to the end of my doctoral degree, including my friends, family, teachers, and colleagues here at CCM. I would also like to recognize the CCM administration and faculty for helping me find a way to keep this recital afloat, despite a car accident in January that really messed up my hand and I couldn't really practice for 2 months and I wasn't sure if this recital was going to happen. So I'm very glad to be here and celebrate the end of the semester with all of you. In this lecture recital, we're going to specifically discuss Joan Tower's Wings, written in 1981, and Fantasy, Those Harbor Lights, from 1989, as well as Libby Larsen's Dancing Solo from 1995 and Song Without Words from 1986. This research aims to expand understanding of the role of the clarinet in contemporary art music and the experience of women composers in the United States, as well as serve as a guide to these pieces for future performers. This work is important because, prior to the late 20th century, almost all successful composers of Western art music were men, and the composers of solo works for clarinet were no exception. The major pieces of the clarinet literature up to this point were composed by the likes of Mozart, Weber, and Debussy, with the most significant American contribution from Copland. As of 2018, when I started this research, the Wikipedia list of clarinet concertos included works by only 6 female composers of any nationality, one of whom is Joan Tower. There were 164 composers on this list. No pre-20th century American composers appear on the list either. Some of the earliest works by Americans are Leonard Bernstein's Prelude, Fugue, and Riffs, written in 1946, Aaron Copland's Clarinet Concerto from 1948, and Walter Piston's seldom performed Concerto for Clarinet and Orchestra from 1967. In 2017, clarinetist and musicologist Albert R. Rice published his Notes for Clarinetists, A Guide to the Repertoire. Of the 35 pieces in the collection, none were written by a woman composer, and the only Americans represented were once again Bernstein and Copland. In this lecture, we will examine the historical moment when all of that changed. Joan Tower and Libby Larsen were the first women whose pieces joined the ranks of the clarinet repertoire due to a variety of social changes that affected both composers and performers alike. I personally think that these pieces have that special something too that made them sort of stick in the clarinet repertoire. I think they're beautiful pieces, and I hope that this will serve as a performance guide for future performers working on these. The methodology behind this project is almost all from interviews that I conducted with Libby Larsen and Joan Tower earlier this year, which was very exciting. They were very generous with their time and answered all of my questions. A few things in this project are from secondary sources, but it's almost all straight from the horse's mouth. Aside from having a similar background in that they were both women composing in the United States in the late 20th century, these two composers also have some similarities in terms of how they write their music. They both emphasize rhythm and time over pitch. I have some quotes from them on this. Libby Larsen said, "I began to think that it didn't matter what pitches I chose, if I could capture the ear and the soul of the listener through the use of rhythm." Joan Tower said, "I put more thought into rhythm and tempo than I do into pitch. I think rhythm is the guiding contextual narrative that makes things happen at the right time, right place, and right speed." Another interesting feature of these pieces is that a lot of them start with very long tones or somewhere in them have very, very dramatic, very long held notes. A lot of times these notes start quiet and get louder, so try to keep an ear out for that as we listen to some of these works. First up, we're going to meet Libby Larsen. Libby Larsen was born in 1950 in Delaware, and she grew up around music and participated in church and school choirs, where she spent a lot of time learning Gregorian chant, which probably influenced her approach to rhythm today. Her catalog spans over 400 works, a large portion of which are vocal pieces. She's considered by many to be primarily a vocal composer. She completed her bachelor's, master's, and doctoral degrees at the University of Minnesota, and she still resides in Minneapolis today. Larsen eschewed the world of professional academia in favor of working with performing musicians on commissions, and she has served on the boards of several music and composers' organizations. 15 of her solo and chamber compositions feature the clarinet, including 2 works for unaccompanied clarinet and 2 works for clarinet and piano. On her compositional process, Libby Larsen has said the following: "I can't remember a time when my head wasn't full of music. I musicalize much more than I verbalize. I didn't think that music was anything extraordinary. I thought that everybody had music all the time in their heads." She also always considers how music will be in the air when she's composing, considering things like acoustics of the hall, the ensemble size, and how the music will actually fit as opposed to just the notes on the page. She said, "I do a lot of thinking about a piece that I'm conceiving. The last thing that comes is pitch and rhythm. I conceptualize about the piece. I spend quite a bit of time on concept. When I'm concepting, I think about tempo, texture, form. I don't write it down or make an outline. I just figure it out in my head. When I think I've got it, the idea that started at the back of my head has moved right up to the front, and then I'm ready to take my paper and pencils and start writing it out." In the 1980s and 1990s, Libby Larsen was experiencing a time of growth, both personally and professionally. She said, "My passion was to build a community in American culture for independent composers who wanted to write abstract music for classical instruments." She had a residency during this time with the Minnesota Orchestra, which was her first major symphonic residency, and she joined numerous boards of artistic organizations and participated in collegiate masterclasses and residencies. Also, her daughter was born in 1986. She said, "I think of it as a time of realization of dreams for which I had no role models. We had to find each other, and we did." She's specifically talking about women professional composers in this time. On her peers in the 1980s and 90s, she says, "I was among those for whom the emphasis was on classical parameters and the innovation of those parameters, with a desire to leave a permanent impression." She said others at the time were participating in the last of the isms, like minimalism and postmodernism, which she didn't really want to participate in herself. She said, "I think I did fit into that larger trend in that I have a deep and abiding passion for acoustic instruments and for the musicians who spend their lives mastering those instruments." On the masculinity of the system in which she worked, she said the following: "I don't know that I felt this way then, but now I feel that there was alienation. It was really due to the systemic development of the world of academic composition. The systems that developed as corporate systems didn't include women at their core. There were women on the edges, but you needed tenacity, a centered sense of self, wit, irony, and a good sense of humor in order to move in those systems. There were other ways of moving in and through those systems which had to do with certain kinds of favors, and a person has a choice. My choice was to use my talent, wit, wisdom, and tenacity to attract mentors who meet at the crossroads of respect for each other's talent. There have been women on the edges, the margins, the shadows for hundreds of years, and I see many more at the center now. We'll see if the center holds." I also felt it was important to ask both of these composers about the voice of the clarinet and how they conceive of the instrument when they're writing for it. Libby Larsen said, "I think of it as a cultural vehicle. There are certain acoustic instruments which I think of as instruments that carry the development of our American culture in equitable ways. For instance, the clarinet was taken up by our classical culture. You hear it in the concert hall, in honky-tonks and dive bars. Woody Allen played it. You hear it as an instrument that's expressing so much of who we are in so many ways." The first piece we're going to talk about is Libby Larsen's Song Without Words. It was completed in 1986 and is composed for clarinet and piano. It was written in memoriam of Richard Lamberton, who was the father of Libby's childhood friend, Deborah. She's still close with Deborah, and she knew Richard pretty well at the time, too. She was asked by the family to write a piece for the funeral service. She described Richard as a quiet and truly kind person who also played the clarinet as a hobby, so it makes sense to write this piece for clarinet and piano. She said, "They asked if I could somehow capture memorializing him and his love and the family that loves him, which I took to mean speaking about him and carrying some part of him in the music I composed. I took on that responsibility to steward the grand emotions of our humanness. A lot of love, basically. It's not a marble statue piece. There's no way to memorialize in stone the soul of a person. And the love is ephemeral, but I think we can do it." She describes the piece formally, which is really a true ABA piece. She says it's going from love to love, not linearly, but as a circle, without beginning or end. The main pitch idea in this piece is a tritone resolving to a fifth, she said, to create time and space. The idea is, am I on earth or am I traveling between body and soul? I wanted to create a feeling of traveling, emotional traveling, that takes place when we're establishing memories of people who are no longer with us physically. The clarinet and piano in this piece are two equally important interacting textures, so it should not be treated as a true solo plus accompaniment. She said, it's the interaction of energy. It really is a solo, but the piano is not an accompaniment. It's the clarinet moving within the piano and the piano moving around the clarinet. It's not a dialogue, it's a flow. She also said, I don't want to ever hear a single beat come through the performance. It should all flow, which means performers should really try to ignore the bar lines in terms of phrasing and take the rhythms sort of with a grain of salt. There are a lot of places where you'll start with a slow note and gradually build into faster notes, and I think those sections should be treated somewhat subjectively and not too beat-oriented. So, like I said, because of my hand injury, I wasn't sure if this recital was going to happen until about 2 weeks ago, so I could not obtain a pianist. But, good news, I've performed this piece before. So we're going to hear a clip from the very beginning from a performance that I gave with piano so that you can hear how the piano and the clarinet interact with one another, and then I'm going to play a section from the end without piano, unfortunately. And like I said, I'm going to play a section from about halfway through the piece that ends on about the sort of climax of the piece. Next up is Libby Larsen's Dancing Solo. This piece was completed in 1995 for unaccompanied clarinet. It was commissioned by Caroline Hartig, who now teaches at Ohio State University. For the work, Larsen invited Hartig to her home and just listened to her practice for days. Libby said, "I wanted to listen to her practice and play. Play me something you love, play something difficult, play something you hate, to find out where the crossroads was. We did that and my mind just exploded. I thought, that's American playing. I hadn't heard those colors before. It was an American classical sound. She never put the clarinet down except for eating." Libby described this as intentionally a challenge piece, which I was glad to hear because I've worked on this piece before and it's very stressful to perform, as anyone who's played it knows. And Libby said, "Accuracy is your job, but making music is what needs to happen. I would write into the score if I wanted to hear the pitches very specifically. Accuracy is part of the preparation, but it shouldn't be part of the performance. The energy is the most important." Also, beware of thinking of this piece as a technical challenge. It's a piece about what it's like to be alive in the virtuosic world in which we live. The piece relies heavily on easily recognized jazz idioms, such as swinging rhythms, vibrato, sudden and intense dynamic shifts, and ostinato patterns. It was inspired by jazz pianist Oscar Peterson, who lived from 1925 to 2007, and legendary dancer and performer Fred Astaire, who lived from 1899 to 1987. Libby especially had his improvisations while dancing in mind while she wrote this piece. Also interestingly, Libby didn't know that those two had collaborated when she was working on it, but it turns out that they did. I tried to find a video, but there was not any good YouTube content with the two of those people, but it's cool to think about. She said, "Those two things came flying into my head, and I trusted that. And a little bit bebop, especially for flat out," one of the movements. "Bebop, jazz, and going fast on a freeway in a car with a pebble stuck in the tire." We'll revisit the driving analogy later on in the piece. The score has the inscription of "Dancing alone, improvising with the shadows, the air, on an inner beat, upon a fleeting feeling, has always enthralled me. In dancing solo, I am making a dance for the clarinet, a dance composed of color, rhythm, beat implied and explicit, and breath. The music is the dance, and the dance is the music." The inscription references each individual movement, although not actually in the correct order, and we will revisit these inscriptions as we go. The first movement is titled "With Shadows." The inscription for this one reads, "Improvising with the shadows." She wanted to be very clear that the long tones in the piece are not the shadows, so anyone who's trying to prepare this later on should keep that in mind. She said, "Players and listeners should imagine Fred Astaire dancing with his shadow on a wall in a black and white movie." Interestingly also, the opening run provides a pitch-based motive for the entire piece, which, as we discussed earlier, pitch is not normally something she's super focused on, so it is extra special that she did come up with a pitch motive for this piece. So I'm going to play an example, which is just about the first page plus a little bit of the first movement of Dancing Solo with Shadows. Thank you. The next movement of Dancing Solo is called Eight to the Bar. The inscription for this one reads, improvising with an inner beat. For this one, Libby says to imagine a tap dancer improvising. The great ones keep the pulse while they consider their next move. Another good example is hip hop duels or just rap in general, where people will sort of vamp while they're coming up with their next verse, right? She describes it as a musical treading of water, the elegance of waiting. So once again, I'm going to start from the beginning of the movement and play just over the first page. The next movement is called In 10 Slow Circles. This is the slow movement of this piece, and I think it's often sort of breezed past by by performers, but I think it's perhaps the most interesting one. The inscription for this one reads, improvising with the air. The 10 slow circles from the title are marked by slurs in the part, so there's just 10 long slurred phrases. Interestingly, it uses elements of serialism with near tone rows for each circle. Serialism, in case anyone doesn't know, is an early 20th century method of atonal composing, wherein each pitch is used only once in a theme. This theme, or tone row, is then treated in different ways throughout the piece, such as forwards, backwards, inverted, etc. Compositions like this are often analyzed by using numbers, where C is usually 0, C sharp is 1, and so forth up to B as 11. Almost all of the circles in this movement begin with the pitch class set 0, 3, 7, 11 when transposed to T0, meaning when they are transposed to start on 0, or C, while preserving the intervallic relationships between the pitches. This is sometimes accompanied by 2, 10, 7, 9, 6, 1, 5, or fragments and remixes thereof. This secondary theme is significantly less pronounced than the other and perhaps a bit more subjective in some places. I think it's also important to note that circle number 5 ends with 11, 7, 3, 0, which is the primary theme backwards, and it's the middle circle. So, as I perform this movement, my trusty assistant is going to change the slides for me so you can see visual representations of each of the circles and the rows that go with them. So, to make the patterns easier to see, the primary theme is going to be highlighted in yellow and the secondary theme is highlighted in green. Libby Larsen confirmed that, while unusual for her, this style of composition was intentional in this movement. She said she wanted to see if she could compose a circle that would be audible to the listener. For this one, I'm going to play the entire movement. It's not very long. The last movement of Dancing Solo is called Flat Out. The inscription for this one reads, improvising upon a fleeting feeling. To me, it feels argumentative, like one voice pushing for change against a very stubborn status quo. But Libby Larsen doesn't see it this way. She says, it shouldn't sound like an argument, more like you're held in place and breaking free from it. Dangerous, and like you could be out of control at any second. Something I learned during our interview is that Libby Larsen likes to drive very fast, like very fast. So she said, this should be the feeling of you're speeding too fast along a highway and you're maybe gonna lose control, but then you get it back, but then, you know. So the more you know. But I'm going to play the first page of the last movement, Flat Out. Now, we are going to meet Joan Tower. She was born in 1938 in New York, and she spent some of her formative years in South America, and later returned to the United States to attend Bennington College for her undergraduate studies, and Columbia University for her master's and doctoral work. She began her musical career as a pianist in the Da Capo Chamber Players, which she co-founded in 1969. She completed her first major orchestral work, Sequoia, in 1981, and she quickly became one of America's most prominent living composers. Many of her popular pieces are for symphony orchestra, but she also writes a great deal for string quartet and other chamber groups. Most of her compositions are for instruments, with only a select few featuring chorus or voice. Since 1972, she has been a professor of music at Bard College. On her compositional process, Joan Tower said the following, I think theory is the death of us all. No offense to the theory faculty. My compositional process is completely organic and intuitive. I don't trust the logic-based stuff. I'm going to use a tritone and it's going to modulate to et cetera, et cetera. I gave that up a long time ago because I was in that whole environment of theory with these mega brains and I was lost right away. I don't have that kind of brain at all. I kind of hid the fact that I didn't understand them. I was surrounded by really brilliant people, but I can't go there. I tried, but me and theory are parting. In the 80s and 90s, Joan Tower was experiencing a period of exploration. She was performing a whole lot with the Da Capo Chamber Players, which she described as her best education ever. She was finishing her doctorate at this time as well. She spent a lot of time playing around with other fields, such as conducting, and obviously she was a performer and a composer too. And she said she did this because she felt if she was going to successfully collaborate with someone, she had to walk a mile in their shoes. So she figured if she was going to write for an orchestra, she better learn how to conduct one. She said she was also completely revamping her compositional style away from 12-tone music. She said, I was surrounded by these very successful men at a young age, and I just thought that's the way it was. They were supposed to win, and I'm supposed to not be heard. Now that I look back on it, that's not the way it should have been. I should have had much more support. In a way, it gave me a chance to develop my own voice quietly and keep rising in my ability to write better pieces. It was a slow path upwards for me, and I think it was much more rewarding. Some of these young hotshots just disappeared, and I think that's a much harder road to go. I'm actually sort of appreciative, not that it was fair, but for me personally, it was actually a blessing. On Music and Feminism, Joan Tower said the following. I'm very much an advocate of women, and I'm a pain in the neck on panels, but once you get to the music itself, the gender is left out. Unless there are words, then you can use those with a gender problem. Without words, such as vocal music, it's an impossible issue. People heard my first big piece, Sequoia, and they said I wrote like a man because it has 64 percussion instruments and it's kind of loud. I didn't like that statement. It was like I had to be embarrassed by the power of my music, and I should never be embarrassed by that power. When I asked her about the voice of the clarinet, Joan Tower actually had something very similar to say, is what Libby Larsen said. She said, I love the clarinet. It's one of my favorite instruments. I've written 6 pieces for clarinet, and I love clarinetists. The instrument is so powerful. It can do everything. It can run around as fast as possible, get dynamics in all registers. It can play short. It can sing. It's an amazingly powerful and flexible instrument. It's also pretty mobile in terms of culture and ensembles. What I don't understand is why it's not featured more in the orchestral world in terms of concertos. Then she sort of answered her own question by saying, mine is impossible. It's the hardest piece I ever wrote. Okay. This is why, Joan. She also said, what I didn't know at the time was that the solo clarinet literature wasn't that big, especially by women. I had no idea where I was historically. I didn't know until I started studying the history of women in music. I had no idea that I was breaking some glass ceilings here. The first piece of hers that we're going to talk about is called Fantasy, Those Harbor Lights. It was completed in 1989 for clarinet and piano after it was commissioned by Richard Stoltzman. Interestingly, by complete coincidence, both of the works for duo in this project are about love, although this is a little bit different kind of love. It was inspired by the memory of her very first love when she was about 16. She was living in Peru and she fell in love with an American Marine who was stationed there. So when she started working on this piece, she tried to channel that nostalgia for that time into it, which she, I don't think, has ever told anyone before. So this is a, now we all know when we prepare this piece what we should have in mind. The opening represents the rocking of the ship as she and her family left the country and she had to leave her Marine behind. So obviously, once again, no pianist. So we're going to listen to a little bit of a recording of the opening section with piano where you can imagine the rocking of the ship. Thank you. Joan Tower and her first love also like to spend a lot of time going dancing together. So in this piece, she uses a jitterbug with a boogie bass in the middle section, and also quotes from their song as a couple, which is "I'll Be Loving You Always." So now we're going to listen to a little bit of a clip of that song. Most of the quotes from this song show up in the cadenza, so I'm going to play about the first half of the cadenza near the end of this piece. The last piece we're going to discuss today is Joan Tower's Wings, completed in 1981 for unaccompanied clarinet. It was written for Laura Flax after they spent a lot of time together in Da Capo Chamber Players performing the quartet for The End of Time by Messiaen. She said, "I was absolutely dumbfounded by the piece. So powerful, so direct, so consonant. At that time, we didn't do consonance or simplicity or accessibility. So that piece really changed my mind. We played it for 7 years straight, and I never got tired of it. That piece affected my way of thinking about time, which directly had an impact on Wings. It starts out with a very long note, which was directly from Messiaen. It's also important to note that Joan Tower thinks of this as really her first mature piece. She thinks that this is the thing that kicks off her entire output as a grown-up composer, right? So anyone who seeks to understand Joan Tower's music should definitely spend some time with Abyss of the Birds from Messiaen and also with this piece. So with that in mind, we are going to listen to a little bit of the opening of Abyss of the Birds, which is the third movement from Messiaen's Quartet for the End of Time. And then after that, I'm going to play the opening of Wings. So once again, this is the very beginning of Wings. Although from the connection to Abyss of the Birds, the title of Wings might seem a little obvious, this piece actually had a different title to begin with. It was originally titled Panthers and then Falcons. The title of Panthers comes from the way that Laura Flax would creep around the clarinet, which Joan Tower described as strong and powerful, but stealthy. Later, the piece developed these soaring motives, plus the little sort of bird calls that we just heard, and she felt that the title had to change. She said she was open to the change because she intentionally allows her music to dictate the title and not vice versa. She also thinks that the title of Wings is one of her best titled pieces ever. Bragging. So I'm going to play a section from the middle of Wings that really exemplifies this powerful creeping that Joan Tower had in mind when she wrote it. last excerpt I'm going to play from Wings is from the very end of the piece, so the last page plus a couple of measures. This section really exemplifies her ideas on height in music. She said that she really thinks about pitches not so much as a set pitch, but their relative relationship to each other. So is it climbing, maintaining, or falling? She said, I'm concerned with the narrative of the action of music, how the music moves physically, up, down, and in time. That's how I propel it forward. I'm very concerned with height. Is it going up, staying, or falling? I'm interested in pushing the envelope in these areas so that you feel a visceral height. To me, music is very visceral, and sometimes I try to push the envelope with that. Wings was a significant turning point for me and gave me the confidence to keep exploring those corners of action. So here is the very last page of Wings. When I asked Joan Tower if she had anything else to add at the end of our interview, she said, I think clarinetists should write more music. Just like that. So I felt like it would be very rude of me to not write a piece for her. She said that she makes a lot of her famous performer friends do this for her birthdays, where she'll ask them to just write a short piece and come play it for her at her house. And she said it's always really interesting and they always get really nervous, which is fun to think about. So I wrote a very short piece inspired by all of the music we've heard today, and of course dedicated to Joan Tower. And the title is Latin for Power Without Embarrassment. So please enjoy.
Thank you.
So this brings us to the end of our time together. I would like to point out that these works are related not only by their composer's similarities, but also by their musical similarities. The importance of rhythm and time without too much emphasis on beat is representative of our time in music history, and it perhaps speaks to the qualities of the modern clarinet that these pieces bear so much similarity to one another. I hope that future performers will take the information discussed in this lecture and use it to connect to these pieces and composers even better than before. Thank you so much.